when historians look back at this time 500 years from now, they will put a breaking point right where we build a space elevator. This is pre-space, and this was post. This is an entire new society. Everything changes.
Imagine simply climbing a cable into space. No rocket. Just press the up button, and you're there. The concept is known as the space elevator. Not only could it significantly change how we leave planet Earth, but it could also completely transform humanity's relationship with space. And there are scientists who think we could have already built it.
We have the material, we have the technology, we have the lasers, we have the climbers, we have all of it. If a private entity wants to build it, or a government, they could build it. It'll change society. We have no clue how colonizing into space, how really spreading out into space will really change our society over the next 50 to 200 years. It'll be completely different.
Ideas of a space elevator type device extend as far back as the 19th century. Russian and American scientists came up with various theories for a structure built from Earth's surface that would reach the stars. By 1979, the concept was relayed to a larger audience by writer Arthur C. Clarke in his novel, The Fountains of Paradise.
I am happy that people are taking it, you know, more and more seriously. And I do think that it may be the way to space.
But these ideas struggle to advance beyond the realms of science fiction, as we continue to rely on tried and tested methods of getting into space.
Right now we've got rockets. They use a lot of fuel. They take a lot of fuel to get up into space. They have to carry fuel to lift the fuel to lift them into space. If you want to go to geosynchronous orbit, it's millions of dollars per pound if you want to go to the moon or Mars. It's expensive. With the space elevator, we reduce the cost of getting into space to dollars per pound. Each climber will ascend the ribbon every day, every couple days, and it'll be taking 15, 25, 100 tons into orbit, which is comparable to what we launch now over the course of a year.
So how does the space elevator even work? The basic idea is a cable would be pulled taut thanks to a counterweight. It stays vertical because the counterweight is thrown outward by the Earth's rotation and the base is held down by gravity. Take a look at this ball on the end of this string. If you swing the ball in a circle at a sufficient speed, the rope will become taut, revolving around your hand. The force pulling the rope taut is centrifugal acceleration. This force, generated by the rotation of the Earth in space, will pull the space elevator tether upwards into space and away from the Earth. In reality, the ball would have to be a large counterweight and positioned above geosynchronous orbit. That's 22,236 miles above the Earth's surface. This is where the outward force pulling it away from Earth is greater than the downward pull of gravity, and that keeps the elevator line taut. Early ideas suggested building a cable from Earth up into space, but the materials needed to withstand such enormous weight don't exist. Physicist Bradley Edwards breathed new life into the theory.
I've been working on the space elevator along with a number of other space systems and new technologies for the better part of 30-some years. I searched for years to find a reason why we couldn't build a space elevator. The materials, the climbers, the power beaming, the low Earth orbit, you know, debris, radiation, just any number of things. Why couldn't we build it? There was no reason. And that was where it started, and I wrote a paper up in 1998 with everything I had found, how you would design it, how you would build it, any problems, issues, that I found. And I published it thinking, well, okay, someone's going to publish the next paper saying, okay, great, Brad, but you know what? You forgot this, 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 and this, and so we can't build it. It never happened.
Brad Edwards' proposal was written for NIAC, NASA's Institute for Advanced Concepts.
NIAC wanted to look at those things that might really change the future. So we put out a broad call for innovative ideas. We got an interesting batch of proposals right off the bat. And one of those came from a researcher, Brad Edwards. One of NASA's initial responses when we brought it to the table as a funded study, before we ever brought it up, you know, they sort of dismissively said, we hope you're not bringing anything like a space elevator in as part of your funded studies. To NASA's credit, they said, okay, we understand now why you're going to pursue this and, you know, proceed. The problem with earlier versions of the space elevator was we just didn't have a way to build the cable that was needed to maintain a space elevator. And Brad came up with an innovative twist, looking into the future on where carbon nanotubes might go in terms of strength.
Carbon nanotubes are something of a supermaterial. Despite their tiny size, they're theoretically stronger than things like Kevlar or graphene. Brad Edwards suggested launching a rocket which would carry the carbon nanotube cable. One end of the cable would then be dropped back towards Earth. The cable would be light enough and strong enough to build just a thin ribbon which robots could climb to build more ribbon, eventually becoming strong enough to carry heavy payloads, such as solar panels, satellites, and even tourists.
So you have to launch all this mass to begin with, and then start building the elevator. Hence, the earlier version that had incredibly massive cables just were impractical. But now, if the projection of the links were to work out, then maybe you'd have something, you know, that could become feasible. You know, a few years ago, the only carbon nanofibers were microscopic. A couple of years later, they were millimeters. Now we're talking about things that are centimeters. And if you project that growth, because people are putting more and more interest in carbon nanofibers, then in 20 years, we might have carbon nanofibers that are kilometers long.
While there have been huge steps in advancing the technology, some people still have their doubts.
Carbon nanotubes exist. They're available. But there hasn't been money going into commercializing them. We've made them. We have put them into plastics, and they increase it dramatically. The strongest steel has a strength of about 5 gigapascals. Carbon fibers, Kevlar, these conventional materials, they will have strengths of about the same, anywhere between 2 and 7 gigapascals. Carbon nanotubes, these are measured at 150 to 200 gigapascals. What we need to build a space elevator is about 60. So carbon nanotubes in these bags are 3 times as strong as we need to make the space elevator. And we can grow them long.
So what about the cost of carbon nanotubes? Is this the biggest hurdle?
Literally, in our system, it costs us about $1 a gram right now on a small scale. We turn that into production, the costs are going to go down. Now, at $1 a gram, that's pretty expensive. And we need about 1,000 tons to build the first space elevator. That's going to be $1 billion. $1 billion is a lot of money. But when you talk about building the space elevator for a total of $8 billion, a large chunk of it being those carbon nanotubes, what you can launch with that system, we easily spend that money launching satellites and whatever else we might launch over the next 10, 20 years. It's not that expensive.
To put that $8 billion figure in context, NASA just spent $10 billion on the recently launched James Webb Telescope. And if Brad Edwards' cost estimate is accurate, the world's spacefaring nations spent enough to cover 10 space elevators in 2020 alone. NASA chose not to pursue the space elevator concept despite things like carbon nanotubes getting longer and stronger. So why do you think that was?
A space elevator doesn't exist in isolation. It exists along with everything else that's in orbit in Earth. And while Brad came up with a very clever design to allow his space elevator tether to survive a few hits every now and then, and he came up with some approaches to allow the space elevator to do an elaborate dance to avoid larger satellites that might be coming through its path, the space debris issue today is a real, real challenge for a space elevator concept.
There's an estimated 128 million objects smaller than a centimeter orbiting the Earth, along with another 900,000 that measure 1 to 10 centimeters, all with the potential to cause significant damage. Brad Edwards' concept would see a space elevator mounted to a mobile oil rig-like structure to dodge any dangerous material.
It's really hard to imagine that you could have a space elevator that could survive the number of collisions that one would expect over the lifetime of a space elevator. And, you know, if the ribbon's cut, you're having a bad day.
Brad, what do you think about the risks of something hitting the elevator?
You know, tracking orbital debris, there's commercial ventures out there that do that. So, you know, to a large extent, we don't even have to deal with it.
There's also risks on Earth, you know, a plane or, you know, a ship or even a storm could impact the structure. If the elevator does break, that'd be pretty devastating.
You'll see the elevator in various science fiction movies, things like that. And invariably, the space elevator comes down and does this crashing, terrible wrap around the planet, destroying everything in its way. Again, we're talking about a ribbon, 3 feet wide, thin as paper. If you break it, if you break the top part off, the counterweight, what happens is the ribbon starts to come down and then it breaks. Because the tension increases, it breaks at the bottom and the entire ribbon flies out into space, never to be seen again. So what you get are a few pieces of this black material, lightweight material that falls down, but it's not gonna destroy a building. It's not gonna break your neck. If you cut it at the bottom, the entire space elevator flies off into space, never to be seen again.
Another reason the elevator hasn't materialized is the dramatic fall in price of launching into space, thanks to the likes of SpaceX and their reusable rockets. But as more countries and companies are sending payloads into space, a real space economy is growing. It's estimated the global space industry could surge to over $1 trillion by 2040. A space elevator could bring huge returns for the team that builds it, which is maybe why a Japanese construction company is funding some research. A team from Nihon University in Tokyo are building robot climbers that ascend a synthetic cable focusing on increasing speed and minimizing power consumption. The company backing the research, Obayashi Corporation, believes a space elevator could aid missions to the Moon and Mars. The scientists say the biggest hurdles are beyond their control.
その開発の資金や何かを 奪い合うというような話が出てきて、それがともすれば戦争のようなものにつながる可能性があるということです。それは国家間でも同様だ。なので、まあ、世界中とは言いませんが、多くの国の賛同を得て、やはり作っていくということが、構築していくということが重要という意味での政治的な問題と捉えています。
The space shuttle has to be operated in a way that it benefits everyone. It has to be that, you know, most anybody can launch on it. Nobody launches any weapons, any military, anything on it. It sort of has to go that way. Otherwise, it gets destroyed. So it comes out where it's almost forced to be a positive thing. Otherwise, it goes away.
There's plenty holding back a space elevator here on Earth. Some think building one on the moon might be the best way to prove the technology. Thanks to the moon's lack of atmosphere, it would also mean the cable could be made from weaker, existing materials, and it'd be much cheaper. But while still useful, it wouldn't give us the huge savings of sending payloads into space from Earth. Either way, the space elevator is still a long, long way off.
I would love to be proven wrong. If we had a space elevator, it would be awesome. It would be paradigm changing because, you know, if we can get to the point of a space elevator, yes, it provides incredible access to space. So I'd love to be proven wrong.
Where the space elevator might take the human species is one thing. What we bring back to Earth might be more important than we think.
We can colonize the moon, the Mars, we can go to the asteroids cheaply, and we can mine them for minerals, metals, that we're running out of now here on Earth. And instead of digging up, tearing up a pristine rainforest someplace to get to those metals underneath, we can go to a barren rock that is nothing more than a large piece of those metals, collect them up, bring them back to Earth without the destruction. It's changed from back in 1998, it was science fiction, you know, capturing asteroids, bringing them in, building large cables. And now we have it. And we probably could have started building it 10 years ago.